four ways to set yourself up for success as a first-time home buyer in the new year. I think next year is going to be a huge, huge, huge thing for first-time home buyers. Credit, knowing your credit score, you know, and getting with a loan officer way ahead of time is really crucial. And I think, Arnie, you could say the same thing. The sooner they know their score and they know their situation, the easier it is for them to make any changes that might be required for them to qualify for a loan, right?
Yeah, it's like grocery shopping. You don't know how much you got in the bank, you know, so.
I mean, you don't know how much you got in the bank. You don't know what your buying power is until you do it. You don't know if there's a credit score concern.
Right.
And then obviously, once you know that, then it gives you a little bit better idea. Also, considering all your costs, a lot of buyers make the mistake of looking at their payment, but they don't look at taxes, insurance, they don't look at utility costs. It's one of the reasons why we a lot of times really encourage first-time home buyers to buy a brand new home, because your utility costs are going to be cheaper, your insurance and taxes, everything's going to be cheaper on a newer home, and it's a little bit easier to break into home ownership by dealing with some of those lower costs, and then factoring in, you know, the budgetary concerns of moving. You know, you're going to have some moving costs, you're going to have, you know, you're going to want to make some new purchases, and you're going to have some repair costs that you're going to need to have in reserve. Being flexible in your search. A lot of first-time home buyers have an unreasonable expectation of what they can buy in the marketplace. You know, they think that they can get everything that they want for the price that they want, and the reality is it's just never the case. Unless you've got millions and millions of dollars, you're not going to get everything on your list. You need to settle for getting the major portions of the things on your list and being realistic. And also being open to some other areas, because sometimes you might have an area that you really want to live in, but what if a great deal with instant equity pops up on another side of town? So, but knowing where you're comfortable living, knowing what that criteria looks like, knowing what you're going to be flexible for, and what's a must-have, and then what's a bonus. And then lastly, you know, keeping your cool. Buying a home can be stressful. Buying your first home can be stressful. It's something you haven't done before. You're going to have to provide a lot of documentation. You might have home sales fall apart. You might have an inspection that causes issues, you know, a home inspection or an appraisal. There are a lot of hoops to jump through when you're buying a home. We do everything we can to help smooth that process out, but there's things out of our control. And, you know, you have to be prepared to kind of keep your composure. One of the things I think that first-time home buyers really mess up on, though, is canceling deals based on inspection, because they've not read a home inspection report. Home inspectors are liability conscious. They put inspection reports together that spook people. They have to say things like, this could be a safety issue, or this could be a code issue. I've read home inspection reports where it's $300 in repairs, but it sounds like the house is falling apart. And home buyers get spooked from it. Most of the time, we see cancellations from first-time home buyers. They're canceling on a home that has things that are going to be normal for a home of that age and price. They're canceling because they're fearful or because they have a thought that they're going to be able to find the perfect home. No such thing. It doesn't exist. You're not going to find a home that has a perfect or a clean inspection report. There's no such thing as a clean inspection report. I've never seen one. I've never had an inspection report that didn't have something on it. It's just natural. So the challenge is the buyer will cancel, and what they're canceling or what the mistake they make. And again, I'm not saying that, you know, if the roof needs replaced and the electrical's shot, you know, I'm not saying that there aren't reasons to cancel, but most of the cancellations we see don't make mathematical sense. So, for example, it's a couple $1,000s in repairs that they might have to come out of pocket for if the seller doesn't agree. So they say, oh, forget it. Let's kill the deal, and we're going to go back out and go shopping. They're going to spend time, energy, gas, interest rates are going to go up, and prices are going up in Tampa at 1% a month. By the time you 6 months down the line, you find the next home that you kicked the one to the curb over $2,000, you spend $12,000 to buy the next house. It doesn't make sense unless it's a big issue. And first-time home buyers really don't do the math on that. They get emotionally invested and they make an emotional decision because they get scared, you know, and most of the time they're wrong. They shouldn't cancel, because if they did the math on it and the next home that they find has the same issues or some of the same concerns, right. And then the next one, and then finally they settle on their third choice and they pay more for it because interest rates went up and prices went up than they would have for the first home, just because of minor issues that they could either work out or they could fix over time. Time isn't in a first-time home buyer's favor right now, you know, and that's something. We got to run to the break, but I think it's a really important thing for us to talk about in the next segment about why it makes sense to keep that deal together a lot of times, because the first-time home buyer doesn't really take that math into consideration. So we'll be back continuing the conversation. We're also going to talk a little later in the show about buying a property through a self-directed IRA or a 401k, and buying a rental property, you know, that Paul can talk about as well after a quick break here on the Duncan Duo Show.